Dr. Afroz, other learned panelists, Dr. Asmadeep. I heard so many things from Prajan sir and Dr. Afroz. First time I'm meeting you. It was a very nice experience. Other distinguished participants and students. The theme of my discussion is religion and political parties. I am not a political scientist, I am not a student of political science, I am basically a lawyer. I teach law, but because of his association, I have developed some interest in this area. So, the political party and religion, there is a very paradoxical situation when I see the constitutional setup in India. Both these concepts, political party, the idea of political party, the institution of political party and the institution of religion, both are given very limited space in the constitution. But you see the reality, both have overtaken everything, every institution. Political party, the word political party was not mentioned in the constitution, in the original constitution. First time it was mentioned by the 52nd Constitutional Amendment Act, and it was with respect to anti-defection law. Political party, the concept was recognized. Otherwise, political power is vested in other institutions like President, Prime Minister, Council of Ministers, Cabinet. Not in political party, but the reality is something different. The real political power is being exercised only by the political parties and by the political bosses. Similarly, the religion. The religion was also confined, has a very confined place in the constitution. Like Article 25 gives freedom of religion, but it was the most restrictive fundamental right within the Part 3, within the fundamental rights. So many restrictions, so many constitutional restrictions in addition to statutory limitations on freedom of religion. For example, it says freedom of religion is subject to public order, health, morality. It starts, this is the only fundamental right in the constitution which starts with limitation. That subject to public order, health, morality and other parts of this fundamental, other fundamental rights of this part, every person shall have freedom of religion. So it starts with restriction. The second restriction you will find in Article 25 Clause 2, which empowers the government, which empowers the parliament and the state legislature to legislate in the name of social welfare legislation. But this paradox which I find in the constitution, how religion and political parties are destroying this constitutional design. The drafters of the constitution, they aspired that India will be a secular constitution, though they did not define, they could not define. I don't know whether it was deliberate or what kind of secularism we wanted in our constitutional scheme. It was not clear because we see various models of secularism. We have one model in United States where we say complete separation of church from the state, where state has no religion, but there is a complete separation from church and state. The second model we find in countries like USSR, where the state has no religion, but the state would discourage religion. In the first model, the state would not discourage. It is not the business of the state. Aapko jo karna kijiye, apne ghar mein kijiye. The state has nothing to do with religion. But in other model, the state would rather discourage the emphasis or over-emphasis on religion or religious activities. We adopted third model, probably, where the state has no religion. This element is common in all the models, that the state has no religion. But state would protect and state would promote all the religions equally. The word equal is very important. So there will be hard subsidy and there will be concessions for or support for organizing like Kumbh Mela or other religious activities. So we thought that we are going by this model where the state would promote equally all the religions, but the recent move by the government to abolish the Hajj subsidy has also put a question mark on this model. What kind of model, what kind of secularism we follow, we are not very sure, and that's why I say that like many other concepts in the constitution, this is a myth. Secularism is a myth, like various other myths I mentioned to you in my presentation. But we are not concerned with the constitutional restrictions on religion. What it is important for this here purpose is a statutory limitation on the freedom of religion that was incorporated in Representation of People's Act, Section 123, which says that no political party will use religion, caste, language, race for polarizing vote or for electoral gains. And recently, the Supreme Court also gave a very important verdict in Abhiram Singh versus C.D. Gomchen, approving that political party, though there is a doubt on the majority opinion, it was a 7-judge bench and decision was given by 4-3. The 4 judges majority said that political parties cannot use or should not use religion, but the minority raised question and they created a doubt on the majority opinion by saying that electoral politics and electoral process, they are 2 different things. Electoral politics and electoral process. Electoral politics, they can use religion because it is acknowledged by the constitution, it is permitted by the constitution. Constitution permits reservation on the basis of caste, reservation for socially and educationally backward class. So unless until you use this concept, you cannot give benefit to these beneficial provisions which are mentioned in the constitution. But electoral process, you cannot use religion or race or language or caste as a ground for taking electoral benefits. Now, how religion is playing role in the electoral politics? The constitution, though, abolished the system of communal electorate, but all the political parties, right from the beginning, since 1950, all political parties, all political leaders used one way or other, directly or indirectly, religion for their electoral benefit. It started with the Congress in the name of soft treatment to minorities or special treatment to minorities. They used the Muslim vote bank politics. They started, and this gave opportunity to other parties to create another institution called Hindu vote bank. If there is, there can be Muslim vote bank, there can be Hindu vote bank also. And this was the platform given by the Congress, which was used by the right-wing parties like RSS and BJP, Jansan. And they used this opportunity. They started movements like Shila Pujan. They started movements like Rath Yatra. Advani's Rath Yatra was very famous in building what BJP is today. Ram Temple is still going on, Now people are waiting for the Supreme Court, and most likely they have now, the time has come. BJP was waiting for somebody as the top judicial person who can help them to solve this problem. And most likely by end of October, when the Chief Justice is going to retire, he will give the verdict. Judgment will come on the last day when he will retire from his office.
But it is given only 1 year. It will take 1 year to solve the case, or before the 1 year?
No, before. By end of October it will be solved. Your Chief Justice. Demolition of Babri Mosque. Four BJP is ruled governments were dissolved by the Congress Party. But this set the agenda, this set the stage for the BJP for the future. Advani ji, who was the leader of opposition, he publicly in the Lok Sabha, he declared or he claimed that we emerged as a second single largest party. BJP had only 2 seats. In 1991-1992 they got 119 seats. From 2 seats to 119 seats, second single largest party, it was because of this kind of agenda which BJP has taken. This was acknowledged in the Lok Sabha by the leader of the opposition. They used Hindu organizations, spiritual leaders like Asaram Bapu, Murari Bapu, most of them are in jail now, taking rest. Kaam khatam ho gaya na unka. Ram Rahim, to mobilize Hindu vote bank. They identified religious places for setting their political agenda. Like they will not do meetings in Delhi. Delhi is not important. They will choose a particular place like Mathura. Why Mathura is important? They will choose a place like Banaras. They will choose a place like Ayodhya to mobilize. And they will also choose, like when they did this Parikrama Yatra in Mathura, and they will also decide the day which will coincide with the Juma or some other minority religious functions. This gives opportunity to other people to create tensions. And this has helped. The vote percentage got increased after this kind of activity they did in Mathura or in such other places. The Prime Minister himself chooses a place for his constituency for fighting election, Banaras, Kashi. It was with a special purpose. See, directly or indirectly, every step of BJP government is trying to mobilize the Hindu vote bank. It is not any person can contest election from any place, any constituency. Legally it is not prohibited. So he chose Banaras because Banaras gave a very good dividend to BJP. Ganga Maiya ne bulaya hai. That is a very beautiful statement which mobilized the Hindu voters. Calling Congress a Delhi Sultanate, Sultan, and the use of Kabristan or supply of electricity on Holi, Diwali in recent UP elections. All these things happened, and the top leader, the top person was involved. He was doing all these things. And nothing happened. In the morning session, the former chief election commissioner was speaking, and he was saying that what kind of work election commission was doing. But all these things were also happening simultaneously. And election commission is not doing anything or cannot do anything. Yogiji, a Hindu priest, was appointed as the chief minister of the state. And he openly, what kind of personality he is, everybody knows. Regularly, frequently, he visits Gorakhdham Mandir. His one of the most important agenda is to visit Gorakhdham Mandir, to visit Ayodhya, to celebrate Diwali, to celebrate all the state expenditure. What kind of secularism we are following? At least one element which was common in all the model, that state has no religion. What is state? They represent state. Yogi ji, Modi ji represent state. They are part of state. Article 12 defines state in the constitution. State includes government of state. But the government is celebrating Diwali. Government is offering Gorakh in prayer in Gorakhdham Mandir. What kind of secularism? Is it not a myth? Now, after the Supreme Court judgment, the Election Commission also swung into action, and they issued two circulars, one for the political parties, another for the electoral officers, that political parties will not use religion, caste, race or language for polarizing vote. And second, for the electoral officers, that you will keep a check. But nothing is going to happen. And nothing happened. There are elections happened, but nothing happened. Then what is the remedy? If this is the situation, what is the remedy? Who can bring some change in the existing situation? Government, we cannot expect. When government itself is involved in all these activities, there is no hope from the government. Then we have Election Commission, Chief Election Commissioner, Election Commission of India, supposed to be an independent, neutral body to conduct free and fair election, which is basic structure of the constitution. And then we have a very active Supreme Court, which has also played a very important role in the past in bringing electoral reforms. But all the three institutions are going through a crisis. Government I will not take. See, let us take for Supreme Court. Or for that matter, all the institutions. All the institutions. In the last 4-5 years, if you see, all the major institutions are under a tremendous decline. Supreme Court captured the power of appointing. Initially, the power to appoint Supreme Court judges was with the government. Government used to appoint judges of the Supreme Court. And they said that it was executive interference and there must be a judicial independence. And in the name of judicial independence, which also is the basic structure of the constitution, they captured this power. Ye power apne le liya. 1993 Supreme Court said that we will appoint judges. India is the only country where judges appoint judges. And what is happening now? The four judges came out in Delhi and they said that democracy is in danger. You are appointing judges. How is your independence? See, government, an authoritative government will create many ways to influence the institutions. And they are doing. Well, they are doing very well. Collegium is appointing judges. They are recommending to the government that you please appoint these two judges. the government will not pay any heed. They are using now the pocket veto. The two judges, Justice Joseph from Uttarakhand High Court, who declared the action of the BJP and governor of the Uttarakhand unconstitutional and restored the Congress government in Uttarakhand, they are not elevating him to the Supreme Court. What can we do? What can Supreme Court collegium do? They can't do anything. If you capture the power of appointment, they have another way. They have post-retirement appointment. They will influence through post-retirement appointment. If Justice Deepak Mishra wants a good position, good post after his retirement, if he wants to become vice president, he wants to become a governor of a state, he wants to become the chairman of National Human Rights Commission, you have to listen what government is saying. And he has realized. Justice Sadasivam gave favorable judgments immediately. The moment he retired, he was appointed as governor of the Kerala. I will give you the list of 15 judges of the Supreme Court and former chief justices of India who were appointed, given good posts and positions. And this announcement was made much before their retirement. What kind of judicial? This is another myth. Judicial independence nahi. Election.
This news only broke out when lady was appointed recently. Because of the lady appointed as a judge in the Honorable Supreme Court.
She is not appointed yet.
And shouted like anything else.
She is not appointed yet. The name is still pending. And government will not approve. Most likely it will not approve. And the election commission. Independent. Free and fair election, which is another part of the basic structure of the constitution, is another myth. There is no free and fair election. You appoint somebody as chief election commissioner who happened to be a chief secretary of prime minister for so many years. See, the chief election commissioner mentioned that justice should not only be done, it must seem to be done. Usi tarah se transparency, independence, should not only be seen, it must seem to be done. Dikhna chahiye ki independence hai, transparency hai. They are accountable. There is a perception. All these institutions functions on perception. Their reputation is built on perception. Gaon ke logo ko kya pata hai andar kya ho raha hai? What is happening inside the Supreme Court, what kind of politics is going on the election commission, an ordinary person does not know, cannot know. He functions on perception. The election commission, and T.N. Seshan was the chief election commissioner, he built a perception. Justice Venkatachalaiya was the chief justice of India, there was a perception that he was a very honest, independent and good judge. Highest integrity. But you are appointing somebody who happened to be your very close associate, and then his actions, post-appointment actions, budget was preponed just before the elections of the four states, four major states including Uttar Pradesh. The budget was preponed, keeping in mind the electoral gains. Nothing happened. Election Commission was silent. The notification for Gujarat election was postponed. Nothing happened. People raised voice, no action. What kind of image Election Commission is giving? And then you decide the case at the last day. Last day bahut important hota hai. All important decisions are taken on the last day of retirement. Last day of your tenure. The election commissioner, chief election commissioner decides very important case related to disqualification of 22 of MLAs.
Half MLAs.
Half MLAs. I'm not saying whether what is what, whether it was right or wrong. It may be right. Legally it may be right. But there are other decisions also pending before the election commission. Choosing only up case will create a doubt on the credibility of the institution. So all these are important questions which I wanted to raise in this conference. I don't have answer what will be the remedy, because I don't find any institution which is willing to reform. The only way which is feasible is we can organize this kind of conferences, we can raise our voice, we can write in popular media, we can publish articles, we can argue in media, though media is also, the integrity is also doubtful. media may be a bahut zyada nahi in aap ek channel pe karenge unke 10 channel hai. So that will also create a kind of wrong perception. So this is all which I wanted to share. Thank you very much for inviting me.